Good morning to all here. I take this opportunity to welcome you to Assam Royal Global University. Before we move on to our webinar topic, I would take this opportunity to say a few words of our esteemed university. With experienced faculty and world-class infrastructure and facility, Royal Global University is one of the finest universities of the country. RGU offers a unique educational experience that prepares the next generation of global citizens to lead and make a difference in the world. With its talented and motivated student body and accomplished faculty, RGU is the leading educational hub in the Northeastern region that maintains a particular commitment to exceptional undergraduate and postgraduate instructions. Under the visionary leadership of our Honorable Chancellor, Dr. A.K. Pansari, sir, on one hand, and under the strategic leadership and dynamic administration capabilities of Honorable Vice Chancellor, Professor Dr. S.P. Singh, sir, on the other hand, our esteemed university has been able to achieve different milestones in its journey of few years. It has recently been ranked as number one private university of Assam by C4 Education World. With highly qualified and experienced teaching fraternity in 27 different schools of the university, with numerous global associations of both academia and industry, and with our dynamic and motivated students, RGU is all-time active to reach beyond the globe of wisdom, intelligence, and creativity. Royal School of Business is one of the prestigious schools of RGU. It is one of the leading B-schools of Northeast India for the last 12 years. Over the years, we have seen our students passing out with flying colors and doing very well in their individual career. With continuous determination to excel and create excellent business professionals, Royal School of Business has its own share of achievement. Under the guidance of Professor C.A. Manoj Jain, sir, and contribution from the experienced and qualified faculty team, Royal School of Business has been ranked as second most promising B-school in India, a survey by GHRDC B-school survey 2019 in competition success review. With this, I welcome you once again to today's webinar. I, Dr. Payal Chaudhary of Royal School of Business and Assistant Professor, would be the moderator of this webinar, which has been titled as Role of Data Science in Empowering Management Decision Making. Before we go on to our panelists to hear, I would like to mention that we have been joined by our esteemed Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, Head of Royal School of Business, Professor Dr. Manoj Jain, sir, the esteemed key speaker today, Mr. Shubhadeep Chakraborty, Assistant VP HSBC, the different faculties of the School of Business and students and participants out at the university also. We are extremely privileged to have you this morning to discuss on this very, very relevant topic. Knowledge is power in business, and data is the fuel that creates this power. Data science uses scientific methods, processes, algorithms, and systems to extract knowledge from the data and leveraging this data to take major decisions in the key strategic practice of business. Data science is an emerging field that utilizes scientific techniques and algorithms to find essential information from a massive stack of data. What lies beneath those massive layers of unstructured data can be crucial to several aspects of business operation. The data can give insights on customer experience, processes that need optimization, information on supply chain, consumer behavior, workflow management, and more in its kitty. With huge amount of data generated by users every single minute, businesses are bound to miss out on a warehouse of consumer insights if they don't invest their efforts on implementing data science and analytics techniques on them today. So with this and with this limited knowledge of myself on this aspect, we start our today's webinar. Before we move on to the industry expert, I take this privilege and request our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, to address our students and audience. But before that, definitely I will take the privilege to introduce sir. Professor Dr. S.P. Singh, sir, Vice Chancellor, Honorable Vice Chancellor of Royal Global University. Sir has been associated with Royal Group of Institutions and Royal Global University from its inceptions in 2009 as a founder director of the institution. He further moved to Amity Education Group in 2013 and joined as the Senior Vice President Academic of the group, and was responsible for functioning of 6 Amity campuses situated in different parts of the country and abroad. He also served as the founder vice chancellor of Amity University Chhattisgarh for almost 2 years before joining the Assam Royal Global University in November 2016 as a founder vice chancellor. With the vision and hard work of Professor Singh, the university has been ranked as the number one private university of Assam by Educational World within a span of just 3 years. More than 3 decades of rich experience in teaching, research, academic administrations, and institutions of repute across the nation, Royal Group is blessed twice to have association of Professor Singh in its journey so far. While serving a second tenure as Vice Chancellor of Royal Global University, Professor Singh has completed almost 20 years of headship of well-known academic institutions of the country. A geologist, MBA, and a law graduate with PhD in strategic management, Professor Singh is also an ardent baseball player and has been actively involved in various social and cultural activities since his university days. Apart from his elaborated experience and milestone, Sir is an extremely positive and energetic person and a wonderful orator. His positive energy not only motivates the faculties, but also each student to perform and work harder. Thank you for guiding us and being there for us always, sir. Sir, I would now request you to kindly address our audiences. Sir, please, over to you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Payal. Good morning to all of you, especially to Sudeep Chakrabarty, Dr. Manoj Jain, and all eminent professors, the teachers present in today's webinar, and most important, my dear students, because they are investing their time on a Saturday morning when normally we are off. So this is a great thing, and you all have joined in good number. I think we are almost 100 plus in today's webinar. So my best wishes to you for the webinar, but then Royal School of Business, they have decided to do this webinar. And if I am to say something about data science, probably that will not be very prudent. Neither I am an expert in data science, but I will try to bring on something which I know about data science, artificial intelligence, big data, machine learning, because they all, in my opinion, are interrelated. But along with AI, big data, data science, and all machine learning and everything, we can never forget about the intervention and the importance of humans. So I always believe that whatever technologies are coming, they are all man-made technologies, and man will always remain superior, whatever the best will come. And even if I've seen the best of the data scientists, end of the day, I have seen that all data, whatever comes out as an outcome of that data, because our speaker today is a very, I would say that he's working with HSBC. He's from Delhi School of Economics. And I think he has got varied experience or working with, I think if I'm not wrong, Shanghai Bank and maybe corporation and some other important places. So this Swadeep is going to tell us more about. But to begin with, I would say that the data science is very, very important. But at the same time, it is not ultimate. I always believe, maybe Sudeep may not be agreeing with me or may agree with me. He has all the right to do that. But I always have found whatever data, the biggest the data, the most complicated data, whenever I've analyzed finally, even then I found something is missing. Something is missing because it can never be 100% complete data analysis, because there are so many things in human mind, so many emotions, so many knowledge around, and so many things you don't remember. You cannot make a program which can contain everything with respect to anything you want to decide. So in a data system or in a computer system, you can always put on those things which you can bring in together and can put it at place, and where the data science is helpful and data science is going to give you some suggestive results. But I would always say maybe I'm thinking beyond data science, you can say that. But I personally have always felt that data science is limiting my decision making to the level of less than 90%. Rest of the things, final decision comes from something else. Now here it comes something which I wanted to talk about. Along with data science, artificial intelligence, big data, machine learning, if individuals are themselves grooming themselves for, I mean, analyzing day-to-day life with data, one, but otherwise also, and always think something which is beyond data. I'm giving you an example. For example, I have to analyze the performance of my teachers who are, you know, who are teaching with me for last 10 years. Payal, I'm just telling you for the benefit of the audience and for all of you. And I can collect data. I mean, I can collect data from 100 sources about their output. Output maybe with respect to their results, with respect to their performance in the class, with respect to the students attending the classes, with respect to their attendance, themselves attendance, with respect to their coming late and going early, with respect to anything and everything, with respect to their behavior, with respect to how many written, I can go to maybe 1,000 points. If I be conservative, I have at least 100 points. But end of the day, when I decide that is that this person, between two person who are very closely been found by data, that they are not suitable or they are the most suitable, the best and the worst, I tell you, I use my prudence, and then data doesn't work, and I found something more than data which help us to decide. You can say this is the sixth sense. You can say this is something which is you are learning and collecting data unknowingly in your mind while meeting people. So while we meet people, while we interact in nonverbal communication and communication, our brain is thousands and maybe millions of times superior than a computer and the data scientists, and that keep on observing and collecting data. And if you are meditating, if you have peace of mind, if you are a genuine person, if you are a person who's good from heart and who is ethical, having values intact, I think all data science fail there. I mean, there comes what you are. I mean, that computer of yours become far superior than data. So this is what I wanted to have a, want to give a different perspective and challenge to Suvadeep so that he can think something more about today's webinar and can bring my ideas, my initial remarks to a platform where the science and humanities and spirituality and eternity together can bring something more conclusive. Because, you know, in Royal, I just don't believe in going mechanical. I mean, in this university, you were talking about Payal baseball. I have watched many movies that reflects baseball. And I tell you, I mean, 25 years back, I mean, one of the clubs in America, the movie has been made, I think it was Golden Pitch or Golden Ball. I mean, if I recall right, the name, Golden Hand, so I have seen that is for India, but the Golden Ball. In that particular movie, one particular club was failing miserably every time. They were one of the best. But then they have employed one data analyst, and he was economist. Economist been employed in a club of the baseball in America. And that data analysis and maybe graphs and maybe diagrams and everything, and that has played a very, very important role in upbringing the club's level to the level that they become the champions. They have become the champion in the club league, I mean, the biggest league in America. The reason was, as I say, because this thought came from, it came in my mind from there, and while interacting with many professors at IIT Kanpur and many other IIT Roorkee. So I, after interacting with many of them, they're the best of the people I know in data science and artificial intelligence. But end of the day, they say, I mean, I'm not saying all. I mean, the few people on this earth, they're who are, as I said, having these qualities of peace of mind, meditation, ethics, values, a kind heart, genuineness, and whatever good word you use for a person. I'm not saying I'm one of them. I try to become some of the traits I try to inculcate in me so that it becomes easy for me to decide. And I know out of 100 decision, 1,000 decision I will take, maybe one or two will be wrong, but 99% decisions are right without doubt. Little support of data in that movie also, end of the day, when the coach or the manager of the team, who is the most important person, he used to take all the data from that person of economics. He was Princeton guy economics in from Princeton. And that person was giving lots and lots of data. Princeton is known for economics and data. But even then, there are three decisions being taken in the movie that has changed the scene of the team was not based upon data. So end of the day, the heart has overpowered data. The psyche and the sixth sense has overpowered data. So in general, so this is my feeling about this science. Very, very happy to know a little bit more from you today. And I read a lot. But then out of all those things, it is a very, very important tool. It is most important thing that everybody should know. It is very handy to reach to the decision of 90%, 95%. Rest, it depends upon your caliber. I know that very well. But not all people will develop that caliber in the initial stage of life. The young people who are into business, because data is, I mean, definitely is helping businesses for extended values that we know. The value, the business, the overall running of a system, and the nitty-gritties of a business with respect to improving customer satisfaction, internal product management, and maybe value chain, and anything, pricing. I mean, you talk about anything, it cannot be done without data analysis. So it is a very, very important tool, and it is a very good fab, and I think which has happened now. But along with data science, if we include artificial intelligence, machine learning, big data, and your own intelligence, and your own heart, and your own decision making, that will become a perfect combination. So I thought I will speak to you 5-7 minutes. I think I have taken almost 7 to 10 minutes, Payal. I always stick to the time.
Sir, I allotted you 10 to 15 minutes. You curbed it, so not a problem.
Yeah, so I think I have taken 15 minutes maybe. I don't know when we professors start speaking, we don't know the time flies off. So I've taken maths, but not more than 15 minutes. Thank you so much, Payal. And all the way to Swadeep Chakravarti and all participants here in the webinar.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much. It's always a pleasure to hear you. And thank you for giving us another perspective, a philosophical perspective of data, which is, of course, required, because data science is just an enabler for decision making. And ultimately, it's the human whom, or the managers, who is actually taking a decision based on whatever it is being produced. So we all understand that and absolutely correctly pointed out, sir. So with permission, I will now hand over the session to Shubhadeep. Shubhadeep, before you take over, I will introduce you to our esteemed audience. So, Mr. Shubhadeep Chakravarti is the Lead Assistant Vice President, Data Science and Analytics Leader, HSBC. Post his schooling in Kolkata, Mr. Chakravarti pursued economics. He is a master's from the prestigious Delhi School of Economics. Post that, he joined Hong Kong and Shanghai Banking Corporation Limited, commonly known as HSBC. He is a data science and analytics leader with 12 years proven track record in delivering analytical solutions with high business impact. Currently, he is leading analytics team for global client acquisition initiatives of HSBC's commercial banking business, developing end-to-end strategies to win new clients for the organization with direct revenue impact through standard propensity-based channels and non-traditional network referral channels using advanced data analytics, innovative use of internal and external data sources, advanced analytical tools, and agile and conventional operating models. Previously, he has been in leadership and analytical roles in marketing and campaign analytics in retail banking, wealth management, insurance, and digital banking, working across geographies spanning US, UK, France, Asia, and Middle East across all asset and liability products. His competencies areas are data science, team management, people management, machine learning, NLP, marketing acquisition strategy, campaign management, event-driven marketing, wealth and insurance analytics, project management, team management, innovation labs, analytics, training, L&D, and recruitment. He has also been recognized by several bodies. Few of his recognition, which I would like to mention, is he has been recognized as one of the top 10 data scientists in India in 2020 by AIM. And he has also been honored as 40 under 40 data scientists in 2020 by Analytics India magazine. With that, I hand over the session to Shubhadeep. We are all very eager to hear you, because we have been always hearing about data and data sciences, and right now we have a person who is handling it real time. So let us hear from you, Shubhadeep. Can we have you on screen? Over to you.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks a lot, Dr. Pyle. Thanks for the introduction. Thank you, Professor Singh. I mean, I know that you mentioned about your perspective of data science, and I have nothing with me with which I can contest you. And as we will go through the presentation, I think we will more and more reach towards the consensus that data science and analytics, they are more of like catalysts for us, which will help us in making better decisions maybe, but eventually the power lies with the individuals. So, I mean, I know that there are certain, say, like conjectures, which does not go in these lines, but eventually I think like all data science will, scientists will agree that no, this is probably the only route, the coexistence between data and humans. All right, let's share something on screen. Okay, can you see my screen now? All right.
Yeah, we can see us.
Perfect.
Just before you start, I just want to request our audiences that if you have any questions during the deliberation, you're welcome to put it in the chat box. We will take up the questions one by one after the deliberation of our speaker is over. We have a Q&A session, so you can put your queries there. We will take it up. And during the entire process, I request all of you to keep yourself in a mute mode. Thank you so much. Shubhadeep, you can begin.
All right. So yes, and again, thanks for inviting me, and you'll have to bear with me with my monologue for some time. But yeah, as Dr. Pyle mentioned, feel free to ask questions in the chat window. In fact, there are no right or wrong questions here, right? And really likely that the questions that you are planning to ask, somebody else might have them in their mind too. And in the next section, we will try to answer all your questions. Our topic is data science for management decision making, and talking about data science, machine learning, artificial intelligence, it is highly unlikely that you have not heard about it. It is practically everywhere these days. You might have in social media, in YouTube, FM, podcasts, blog, or if I pass on to the next slide. You see, even at the back of an auto, right? And yeah, this is quite innovative of the advertisers to utilize the real estate at the back of auto rickshaws to market data science. In fact, my he was using a factory reset version of my wife's old phone last week, where he was watching the nursery rhyme, Three Little Monkeys Jumping on the Bed. And the video got interrupted, and an ad started playing. It said, "Do you want to build a career in data science? Start planning now. Enroll with us." So no matter what, you cannot escape hearing about data science. Thankfully, kids these days, they know how to skip YouTube ads. And in case you are wondering that what Three Little Monkeys Jumping on the Bed is all about, never mind. I mean, 3 years back, even I had no clue about it either. But from what we see here, one thing is pretty certain, that there is a huge current demand in the field of data science. In fact, there is a wide gap between the demand and supply, which these data science institutes, they are trying to address. Data science and AI apparently have been transforming all major industries for a couple of years now. Almost all industries and companies, they are realizing that investment in data science and AI will lead to advantage. I was attending the Computer Vision Developers Conference last month, and somebody presented it on screen that 99% of the Fortune 1000 companies, they are investing in strategic big data and AI initiatives. Quoting another source, so according to the recently updated numbers of the International Data Corporation or IDC, spending in AI systems will reach about 100 billion in 2023, which is about 2.5 the 40 billion investment that was done last year. AI is high on the agenda on Indian government too. If you remember, In the union budget last year, it was revealed that government plans a national program on AI, for which the government will set up a national AI portal. As some prefer to put it like this, that data is the new oil and AI is the new electricity. You might have like heard about this, right? And this is why the job market is playing catch up to meet the increased demand. According to LinkedIn, 3 out of the top 8 emerging jobs are related to either AI or data science. So now that we have seen the supply and demand, let us take a pause and understand what this data science is about. You may think that, like, I am referring to data science, AI, analytics, machine learning, deep learning, advanced. Are pretty much well defined and are like either synonyms or a subset of one another or are partially overlapping with each other. So all are kind of related to each other. Data science in general, it refers to scientific methods, algorithms and systems to extract knowledge or insights from the data. And the sole purpose of data science in one sentence is to solve complex business problems using data and algorithms. As simple as that. Right? In your everyday life, you may have come across hundreds of applications of data science. We skip to this page. Okay. So before you are going to college, you might be checking the weather forecast of the day to see if it would not. And based on that, you can plan to carry an umbrella accordingly. Or while commuting to your college, you might have checked the traffic in Google Maps to see if there is traffic on your route. I'm sure that traffic in Guwahati or in the north not as bad as Bangalore. But then again, in Google Maps, you can precisely get the time based on the traffic condition and also suggestions of alternate routes which you may take to make your journey faster, right? So that you can plan accordingly and you do not miss your morning class. Now, when you are composing an email in Google, you might get the prompt about one sentence based on the context in the mail. Say, if you have typed that I would be towards the end of the mail, you would probably automatically get the suggestion that waiting for your reply followed by a full stop, right? You all might have encountered this. Isn't it as if Gmail is kind of reading your mind? If you are taking a, say, like group photo in your cafeteria and then you are posting it on Facebook, will suggest the names of the friends who are already in the photo and will suggest you to tag them well. Does that not make you feel that Facebook knows all your friends? If you are in, say, Netflix or shopping in Amazon, you get recommendations of movies and products, which you then end up watching or buying. So again, does this not make you feel that these companies, they know your preferences better, maybe even better than your best friend? In fact, McKinsey, they reported that 35% of the Amazon sales, they comes from its product recommendation. And by the way, so in Netflix, so 75% of what we watch are the recommendations of the videos that are offered to us. So no doubt that this explains, right, that why these companies, they are heavily investing in data science. In the COVID situation, if we kind of understand this clearly, then data analysis is our only hope as of now, because with the vaccine like far away in sight, our only savior is data, using which we can identify hotspots so that we can stay away from that area and infected people using, say, geotagging. We can take precautions that to come in contact with a COVID positive individual, then we will get warned and we can take precautions accordingly. And all this is possible, say, using the Arogya Setu app, which is doing its job pretty well. Right. Okay. And since our topic today is about how data science helps in management decision making, we can start talking about how the usage of data can help management by providing all the key numbers that they wish to look for to run their business to grow their business or to take informed decisions. So suppose you are the CEO of a retail company which operates in 10 countries across the globe. Now all the different countries, they will use their own local systems to store customer and transaction data. And some of the data is not even stored in digital format, right? It will be stored in maybe as paper, right? And then there will be regulations on inter-country sharing of data. And on top of it, you have lost maybe some of the data due to a security lapse. The nightmare, right? But let me tell you, in real life, this situation is extremely common. And I have seen that it can get even worse. But think of you as the CEO who would like to have all the information related to your company at your fingertips. So here a data-powered dashboard comes handy. Executive dashboard is what we see, something similar to what we see on screen, is a simple reporting tool that provides a visual display of the organization's KPIs, metrics, and data. The objective of the executive dashboard is to give CEOs like at a glance visibility into business performance across all units, across all projects, and well-designed dashboards, they will summarize all the complex data points into easily digestible snippets so that it can be translated into clear actions for the entire business, right? And if a particular KPI warrants investigation, it should be giving some drill down functionality so that you can drill down the data and get into the root cause. It should contain all the financial KPIs like the revenue, the quick ratio, the short-term assets. It should have a high-level view of the performance of each and every department in the organization. It should show, say, key accounting KPIs like account receivables, payments, income, the top customers by income, the vendor expenses, and more. It should also, in fact, summarize the sales performance, the employee performance, and so on, right? So that you as a CEO, you can not only feel, but you have actual control of what exactly is happening with your company. And maybe on a, say, real-time basis or near real-time basis, right? So you, if you are the CEO or the management team is having all this information at their fingertips, real-time or near real-time, they will be able to take informed decisions on, say, where to expand business, where to open or close a new store, which department needs more hiring of employees, which products to market more, whether to change your marketing budget, how much provisions to be made to account for various risks, employees to reward, and so on. Now, although this itself is like super powerful, this is only the tip of the iceberg. Right? This is only the tip of the iceberg when we speak about how data science can help in management decision. If you look at the different stages of evolution of data decision making, this in fact is the very first stage, the stage which we just spoke of. So what we spoke of is predictive analytics, statistically to tell you what happened in the past, right? Descriptive analytics, it helps businesses in understanding how it is performing by providing context to help stakeholders interpret the information. So in the current healthcare setting, for instance, say there is a high, like, or maybe unusually high number of people are admitted to the emergency room in a short period of time. So descriptive analytics, it will tell you that what is happening. So it will give you real-time data about the corresponding statistics like date of occurrence, what is the inflow, volume of patients, the patient details, etc. Right? Then comes diagnostic analysis, which takes the descriptive data to a like step further and provides deeper analysis to answer the question that why did it happen? So often diagnostic analysis is referred as the root cause analysis. So this includes using processes such as data discovery, data mining, data drill down. Again, in our example, diagnostic analytics would help us to explore the data and make corrections. For example, it will help us to determine that, okay, if all the patient symptoms are similar to each other, say high fever and dry cough and fatigue, then it will point that there is some infectious agent and it might be the symptoms of COVID. So you now have an explanation for the sudden spike in volume in the emergency room. Now comes predictive analytics, which takes it to the next level. So it takes historical data, feeds it into a machine learning model that considers key trends and patterns. The model is then applied to the current data to what will happen next. So back in our COVID example, predictive analytics may forecast a surge in patients admitted to the emergency room in the next several weeks. So it will give you exactly how many patients, I mean, not exact, but an estimate of how many patients would you expect each day for the forecast period. Based on patterns in the data, the COVID illness is, say, spreading at a rapid rate. Now comes the final stage, which is the prescriptive analytics. It takes predictive data to the next level. So now that you have an idea of what is likely to happen in future, you do. So it will suggest you the various course of actions and outlines what the potential implications would be for each. Now that you know that the hospital expects this many number of patients each day in future, so simulation will be done on all available levers to point out the most optimal next course of action. It may suggest how many ventilator machines and other infrastructure do you need to buy or rent? How many staffs can you increase to meet the influx of patients and fight the disease? These different stages, they add immense value to the business in terms of increasing profit or reduction in cost or an enhancement in customer experience. Now you might ask, why did we not do all this before, over all this year? Of course, we have been doing this all along. But why are you not hearing about data science buzz today? The kind of buzz that you are hearing today, why did you not hear the same buzz about data science, about AI analytics, say in the past decade or even 5 years back? The reason is that a whole lot of progress in the field of data science happened in the past few years. And that has now set the stage for doing things which were completely unimaginable few years back. I think I would love to spend a few minutes talking about the evolutionary story. So understanding that, like, who are the giants on the back of whom right now? So there are a few aspects. So the revolution in data storage. IBM, they introduced their first commercial computer with a magnetic hard drive of 300 MB of RAM. And the entire unit, it was like 30 feet by 50 feet kind of physical structure, probably the size of your lecture hall. And it weighed about a ton. And for $3,000 a month, companies could lease the unit and store up to 5 MB of data. Can you imagine? So in the next 60 years, the prices per gigabyte, it dropped from a whopping like 2 billion to 2 cents in 2020. Now, besides being cheaper, data storage also became much denser, where you can now store 1 TB of data in your pocket. The combination of dramatically reduced cost and size in data storage is what makes today's big data analytics possible. So with ultra low cost storage, building of data infrastructure to collect and extract insight from huge amount of data, it became a profitable business. Earlier, although it might have been possible, but it was not like a profitable business. The second is about data capture. We have now been capturing enormous amount of data. Capturing. When you log into the internet and you log into, say, any product page, captures pretty much everything that you are doing, which pages you are visiting, in what sequence, how much time you are spending on each page, which text on the page you are highlighting, or even on which items you are hovering over your mouse. So you can imagine, right, that session of yours can produce thousands of lines of data. With IoT or internet, things devices coming up in the last decade, the data captured is now unprecedented. Your personal Safebit, it is monitoring your activity, your heartbeat, your sleeping pattern round the clock. Your home assistant Alexa is registering all conversations to serve you better, right? So that is about capture revolution. Now comes the database structures. And although subtle, but this is like very big progress in data science where we stand today. Data, we are storing them cheap, but how do we ensure that the data is usable? There are say 15 million Uber rides per day, say 29 to 30 million of WhatsApp messages. I was Googling this up yesterday, and some photos getting uploaded in Facebook every second. And interestingly, have you noticed that most of these activities like emails, audio, chat messages, social media posts, they generate unstructured data, which account for 80% of the total data and is growing twice as fast as structured data. This is not the type of data we used to know before, but this is a new type of data. And the relational database systems, it emerged in the 90s to store data as tables in the form of rows and columns. And we could query those using structured query language or SQL statements, right? And you can maintain a database. Database is like basically a collection of tables, like the data in rows and columns, which Excel, but they are connected using primary and secondary keys. The relational solving our purposes quite well for numeric or categorical data types, like say orders, payments, but then they are terrible at storing unstructured. It was also more expensive to set up, maintain and grow, and by mid the existing relationship databases, they could no longer handle the changing need. Few online businesses. So came the no databases or the NoSQL databases, which developed as a result. Now, without any known solution at that time, each of those online had their own approach to handle the massive amount of unstructured data. For example, Google created GFS, MapReduce, Bigtable, Amazon created DynamoDB, Yahoo created, Facebook created Cassandra, and Hive, Link, Kafka, right? So some of these businesses, they even open source their work, and that resulted in the proliferation of databases, and NoSQL became a major player in the industry. And NoSQL databases, they are like kind of, they offer a lot of flexibility to store and manipulate data, and in fact horizontally scalable and even like fault tolerant. So this like subtle revolution. But then there comes the next channel. We have the data, we know how to store them. Next, how do we process such large amount of data? So while storage, they grew manifold in the past decade, traditional hardware had not advanced enough to keep. The computational power required to handle most big data analytics, it takes ages to process. Even 5 years back, so me and my colleague would pull from not even very big, but moderately large transaction tables, and we could conveniently take long coffee breaks and lunch breaks, knowing that the query would run. Time to run. In fact, the longer queries we would run overnight for weekends, and for some, we simply could not run it as it would take ages and will turn network. To overcome this deficiency, many new technologies they evolved, including computers working together, distributing the database to thousands of commodity servers. So when a network of computers is connected to work together to accomplish the same task, the computers, they form a cluster. And the cluster can be thought as a single computer, but can dramatically improve the performance, the availability, the scalability over a single powerful machine and at a much lower cost. So that is Apache Hadoop and the boom of parallel processing. Hadoop help us data and track our data across multiple distributed physical hard drives. Then there is the, I'm using a few jargons, but never mind. So for example, MapReduce would like process the data across the distributed processors. And then there will be some cluster management tool, which will play the orchestration that will distribute the CPU usage monitored across all the different computers. So as if your work has been distributed to say thousands of different machines and somebody is orchestrating the work to get it done across all the machines, right? This sounds, but again, MapReduce, it processes and therefore is not suitable for processing real-time data. So came Apache Spark in 2012, not very long ago, to fill in that gap. And Spark, it does almost the same thing in memory, which allows Spark to run programs up to 10x to 100x than Hadoop. So now you see how processing became easy. The other revolution is about cloud services. Data analytics capabilities. In the old days, the businesses, they had to buy on-premise data storage, on-premise analytics solutions. They had to purchase software and hardware from vendors, usually paying perpetual and hefty license fees, right? And on top of this, there was cost of power, cost of cooling, security, data protection, IT stuff for building and maintaining the on-premise infrastructure. And with the entry barrier, you can imagine, right, that the entry barrier is huge because you will need to have a massive setup to do all, right? So many potentially valuable data collection and analytics possibilities used to go down the drain. But in 2000s, the cloud service platform, Amazon, AWS, Google Cloud, Microsoft Azure, they provide subscriptions to a wide variety of services delivered over the internet on a pay-as-you-go basis, offering access to flexible and low-cost storage and virtual computing resources. So you only need to pay for what you are using. You do not need to make any purchases whether for hardware or for software. Direct investment, but rather you can actually pay for whatever service that you are using. You don't even need to purchase softwares or upgrade them. So everything is taken care of by the cloud. Right? Softwares. In fact, there was a. In fact, when we started analytics, SaaS, the license alone, it came at a cost of $3,000 annually for the base version, along with huge server cost. The base version even had limited functionalities and advanced modules. They came with like further additional costs. It was difficult for students and for small companies to buy SaaS licenses for all. SPSS was another good tool, but now, standing today, Python and R, they are the main technologies for the data processing course for the data scientists. These are the open source tools, so they are virtually free. They have vast, ever-evolving libraries. They have excellent community support. They also have the ability to integrate big data platforms as well. And they can integrate visualization products too. So these two, the R and Python, they are not only popular today, but they are going to stay here for quite some time, or maybe like for the next 10 years at least. Comes algorithms. So talking about algorithms, when it came about building statistical models, most of the common choices that we had in the past was what we now call as the shallow learning techniques. So we used to use, say, linear regression or naive Bayes logistic regression, simple chain, or if we are doing forecasting exercises, you'd use like univariate time series methods like ADIMA or ADIMAX, right? K-means for clustering. Some of the terms you might not have heard, but never mind. But what I'm trying to convey here is that right now, there are a lot of like more powerful algorithms which will uncover patterns within the data and will provide higher accuracy for our models which we are building. Say, for example, if we are trying to predict or do some classification, then LiveGBM, CAD boosts, they come at the top of our mind. These are the ones which crack the Kaggle challenges, right? So similarly, there are a lot of developed, like the auto encoders, the LDAs and gloves for natural language processing, right? And there are some high-end optimization techniques like simulated and annealing or genetic algorithms. And finally, during my initial years, reports were mostly developed in Excel. And we used to use VBA for complex functionalities, or used Cognos for reporting and visualization. Nowadays, most organizations, they are going shelf products like Tableau, ClickView, Power BI, which provide excellent visualization capabilities. In fact, the one that I have on screen previously, that was built in Tableau, right? Technologies like D3JS as a low-cost option to develop customized and visually appealing interactive. So this is about the history and the how the evolution happened and why we stand where we are standing today. Now let us quickly revisit the buzzwords that we spoke about, as by this time you might have a like clearer picture of each of the buzzwords and what they mean, so that you can use them in the correct context. So artificial intelligence is the concept of building systems which tries to mimic human intelligence. So anything which tries to mimic human intelligence but is not human, that's under the purview of artificial intelligence. It includes robotics, it includes building simple if-then-else logic, as well as machine learning. And so machine learning is a set of artificial intelligence or AI, and it only deals with the processes which involves teaching a machine how to come up with its own logic rather than explicitly coding it. Say, for example, the name of books and the corresponding authors to the machine, and then any of these authors, they come up with a new book, the machine would be able to predict the author's name based on their writing style. So that is machine learning. So it will not require any explicit coding. If the book contains words like, say, Chicago, then it might be Mr. Shashi Tharoor. It will not work that way. So the machine will come up with its own logic. And now machine learning, it has three key components. And reinforcement learning. They are simple, so don't get too overwhelmed or confused. So supervised learning is used when you have a clear classify books and assign them to one. That's supervised learning. If your objective is to find and explore the writing style of the authors, to create clusters or segments to better understand writing styles are there, or which authors can be classified together based on their writing style, that we use is unsupervised learning. And reinforcement learning, I'm not going deeper into it, but it is a hybrid of supervised and unsupervised. And then machine learning can use any algorithm, but if it is using neural network, which is a specific branch of algorithms, then the discipline is called deep learning. As simple as that, right? You might have come across the word deep. And the specializations within machine learning can be on the basis of the type of data that you were dealing with. If you were specifically working on unstructured text data, then the branch is called the natural language processing or NLP. If you are working with, say, video footages, then that particular specialization is called computer vision or CV. And big data is data whose like size is not only huge, but also it should be dynamic and should be complex in nature. In fact, if we go by the definition, it should have the three V's, the volume, the velocity, and the variety. And often dealing with such data is referred as the big data analysis or big data analytics. So You see that loads of buzzwords, but actually it is quite simple, not that complicated. Okay, now seen that how data science has reached this level, which happened in the past few years. Let us pick a few examples. Okay, so I would start with gaming. Because that is interesting. So you might have seen that the casinos, they have historical and real-time data of everything that the people are doing there, like even using how they are using the restaurants, the spa, the golf course, and the purchases they are making there, and the time that they are spending in the slot machines. And data from the casino floor, it is constantly fed into the to individualize the incentives for spending and gambling. To match gambler to the experience, for example, a company called Caesars, they developed a digital interface for its games. So if things are not going well for a particular game, a staff member can direct a player to another machine. So it all happens in the back end in real time. Casinos may also incorporate data and analysis of their customers to the overall layout of their floors, increasing the customer relationship value and forcing security threats. Healthcare is one of the oldest users of like data science and machine learning. In fact, I would talk about a couple of cases. Say, for example, a company named Propeller, it enabled a GPS tracking device which records the inhaler usage by asthma patients. So this information is collected, analyzed, and is merged with the asthma catalysts for the different geographic locations and help doctors learn how to prevent attacks. So if I am an asthma patient and I have reported an attack after I visited, say, a particular area, then it will send a trigger to the doctors that, okay, there is something wrong with this particular area and we should be avoiding that area. And so I should be informing the same to my other patients. So that's cool, right? In fact, in 2008, the Google staffers, they did something similar. They discovered that they could map the flu outbreaks in real time by tracking the geographic location of flu-related searches. So if there are a lot of people who are searching in Google about flu, then it might be the case that there is a flu outbreak in that area. So I have a flu, I am searching it. I do not know that there is an outbreak. But then Google will know that, okay, since a lot of people, they are searching the same thing in a particular geographic location, there might be a flu outbreak there, right? And then there are like other companies like Encora's radiology team. They in fact did a fantastic job of mining 15 years worth of data on diagnostic treatment plans and outcomes and side effects from more than some like 50,000 cancer patient records. And based on that, they came up with an algorithm to suggest personalized chemotherapy and radiation regimes, right? So it's like not a one size fit all thing, but customized plans for every single patient based on their exact needs. Also popular in the travel industry, you might have encountered, right, your experiences with airlines. So airline, they optimize its revenue through dynamic pricing, and this is a pure data science. You collect data about demand and supply in real time, along with studying historical trends and patterns to predict the most optimal price points, and all within a matter of seconds. So you search, and the price that you get, so there is hardly any difference, maybe a few seconds, and a lot of things they happen under the hood in those fraction of a second. Road routes. So although data-driven route adjustments, they are small, but they can help thousands of gallons of gas when they are spread across hundreds of trips and vehicles. In fact, a company named UPS, they uses data science to optimize package transport from the drop-off to delivery. And it incorporates machine learning and AI to track the challenging logistic puzzles, such as how packages should be rerouted around bad weather service bottlenecks. So you see this rerouting, the one that we were talking about, Google Maps. In fact, Uber did. So they spent a lot of data science towards a very simple goal. They should be getting their food hot to the customers. So in order to optimize the food process, the team had to predict how every possible variable from storms to other natural calamities to holidays, they will impact the traffic and the cooking time. Okay, so talking about sports, Professor Singh. So the movie that he was talking about, it's called Moneyball. And Moneyball is actually a true story of the baseball club manager. So it was in fact played by Brad Pitt, like who challenged the old conventional system of selecting baseball players for his team. He like took help of an economist from the Yale University who analyzed the different baseball players' data using analytics. He gave the list of undervalued players who were there in the team's who would fit into the team's budget. In fact, the team was operating on a like shoestring budget. And then they finally became the winning team because of the kind of smart discovery of the undervalued players. Yes,
Moneyball.
Sir.
Yes, Moneyball. Yeah.
Yeah. So yeah, highly recommended. So yeah, students also, if you have not watched it before, do watch it. It's very interesting. In fact, very early, there was another one. So, and this is very recent as well. So the Liverpool soccer team, it like almost won the Premier League championship in 2019. And that with the help of data science. And the idea was that like to recruit undervalued soccer players and they didn't have the budget of its United. So it had to find great players before rich teams, they realized that how great they were. So you see that catching players before they make it big. So that required like data science and analytics. In fact, Ian Graham is the data science who is now the head of the Liverpool team. They figured out how to do that. In fact, they built a proprietary model to calculate how every pass, every run, every goal attempt, it influences a team's overall chance of winning. So Liverpool has used it to recruit players and for general strategies as well. In fact, in basketball too, so the teams, they started attaching a sensor on the hoop's rim. So whose camera tracks exactly when and where the ball strikes on each basket attempt. It funnels that into a device and displays the shot details in almost real time to generate predictive analytics how to improve the game. Now, we can also talk about government. In fact, there is this company called Equivant, which built a software which attempts to gauge the criminals' risk of re-crime so that they can set up proper surveillance. So isn't it interesting that whether a criminal will do something offensive again or not? In fact, in 2002, so soon after the World Trade Center attack, the US government started to develop the what we now call the Total Information Awareness System. So this project will use biometrics, image processing, predictive modeling to analyze the government data sets. It would examine from communications to medical to travel history to identify suspicious individuals. Of course, there is this privacy angle here, but again, here we are talking more about the data science. Say, for example, tax evasion, right? The government, in fact, many government agencies, they improved the efficiency of like taxing by constructing multidimensional taxpayer profiles from social media data, from analysis of emails, from electronic payment patterns and more. And profiles, what the agencies are now doing is they are forecasting individuals' tax returns. And anyone, the wide gap between the forecast and the real tax returns, they gets flagged for auditing. So isn't it? In banking and finance, well, this is my domain, right? So I can talk about it for hours. But again, and now utilizing the data science is to proactively detect fraud and provide customers with high level of security. So this is done by monitoring and analyzing users' banking activity, auspicious or malicious patterns, right? So whenever you get something fishy, even before that, say for example, if you are making a transaction of your credit card and then it does not fit pattern with how exactly you generally use that credit card, right? So suppose you are purchasing a huge amount of gold, which you generally do not do. So in that case, this will be flagged automatically by the machine as a suspicious activity. And then you will get a confirmation call that, hey, did you actually do this transfer? Are you sure you want to do that, right? So banks also need to predict future revenues based on the input from the past. So this is based on using predictive analytics to calculate the future value of the customer. So this helps in segregating customers, identifying the ones with high future value, and so that you can invest more resources on them in terms of customer service, in terms of offers, in terms of discounted pricing, right? Banks, another like very important use case is in credit risk screening. This allows the bank to predict how their loans they are going to be repaid and foresee if a default is going to happen or not. Now the risk model team, it calculates the risk of each and every case, and only when they are satisfied using data and analytics that a customer's say risk propensity is not very high, then only they will grant that particular loan. In fact, in communications, in media, in entertainment, yes, there are a lot of examples. Say telecom companies, they are now able to identify like customer's physical location based on his or her smartphone. And this leads to partnership with the advertising companies and crunching the numbers. These advertising companies, they can identify the geographic patterns and relationships that the advertisers can use. Say, for example, if you go to the, if you usually hang out in the nearby mall, start getting ads about the offers and discounts in that particular mall on your, say, message or WhatsApp. Specific targeting. In fact, in communications, there are other examples as well. In case of media, so Spotify is quite common, right? So the on-demand music streaming recommendation engine to suggest recommended music to its users. Even in fact, that is also seeing a wide influx of data science use cases. In fact, the University of Tasmania, I was reading it the other day, that they developed a learning and management system that can track when the overall progress of a student, how much time they are spending on different pages, and a lot of other things. And this will help in developing strategies to provide enhanced focus on the lagging students. Big data can also be used to measure teachers' effectiveness by fine-tuning teachers' performance by measuring against, say, the subject matter, the student numbers, the student aspirations, student demographics, and many other variables. Hey, by the way, do you know that Zoom, the video conference facility, it has this attention monitoring feature which tracks the attention of the attendees? So even in, during the COVID times when you were doing a Zoom call, it has the functionality to track that how much time an attendee is looking at the screen, toggling between other applications, keyboard strokes to generate an attention score. So that is quite creepy, I would say, right? But anyway, we are using WebEx. So these are about the different industries, but even within a particular industry, we can look at the different verticals, and each vertical, they will have a whole lot of use cases. Say, for example, the marketing team, they would plan their marketing budget, that is how much to invest in, say, above the line targeting and how much in the below the line targeting, and within above the line, how much to invest in TV ads, in, say, FM ads, in banner ads. So this is an optimization problem, a pure data science problem, right? In case if you are in working for sales, so it will give you idea about who are the customers to target for a particular product, right? Instead of maybe reaching out to every customer, so if you can understand that, okay, this is the need of the customer. So if you can discuss on those lines, it will help not only you to make a sale, but also It will help the customers because they will realize that, okay, so the sales team, it actually cares about what I need or want rather than offering everything to me, right? In terms of in say vertical like HR, it will help us help you to predict that who are the employees who are more likely to act right in the next 1 year. So based on that, you can devise your retention strategy so that you can retain the best talent, right? Even call center. So like, say for example, how the typical call center problem is that how can you optimize the system to reduce the waiting time for the customers so that they get a better, like the customers get a better calling experience. So all these verticals, they use data science, or at least they should be using data science. But then again, having known all this, there are some challenges in our industry too, and it will not be complete to not cover those challenges. So industries, we have our own share. The first one is about issues. Now, data science itself, as we should understand, that it is ethically neutral.
Shubhad, small interruption. Flooded with one particular aspect. Because you have just touched on this, I'm just so that you can cover and we can take up the other questions. The questions are related to data security, ethical use of data, and data protection. So while you are addressing the challenges, if you also take up these, would be great.
Absolutely, absolutely. So in fact, ethics is something which is quite an interesting subject. And as I was telling you that like data science is ethically neutral, so it will not have a mind of its own nor a perspective. So it will not know that what is wrong or what is right, nor what is good or what is bad, right? So data science has no value framework, but the organizations who are using data science, they will have their own values in place. So by asking or seeking answers to various ethical questions, one can ensure that particular data science related, say, solutions, they are used in a way that aligns with the organization's ethics and values. In fact, let us take an example. In, I think, 2015 or 16, so Microsoft, it launched a chatbot named Tay, T-A-Y, Tay, on Twitter to interact with the Twitter users and learn from her interactions with real human beings. So the initial conversations, they were very positive, but within a few hours and after interacting with thousands of tweets with especially with trolls and jokesters, so this particular chatbot, it started spewing negative, misogynistic or even racial tweets. So subsequently, Microsoft had to take it down within 24 hours of its launch, and it had to manually many of the offensive tweets. So if there is bias in data that is fed into machine learning, then the machine might behave in a way which is not to gender or race. And so a lot of effort to remove these biases from the data. And if you are already building a model, so there are two things that you need to take care of. One is that when you are feeding data, because whatever you are feeding to the machine, it will learn that. So if you are feeding biased data, then the model will get biased, the machine learning intelligence will get biased. So you need to remove the bias even before you feed the data to the machine. And the second thing is that, of course, you cannot take care of all these cases. I'm sure that Microsoft, they took all the precautions, but they did not see this. So the other thing is that once you have launched something, you need to do some extensive testing on it, especially on the grounds that whether or not how it is interacting on the ethical issues, right? Probably Microsoft, they did not test it, say, comments from these jokesters or comments from these trolls. So they interacted with good people and they saw that, okay, the responses are quite good and it's a great solution. So these are the things that we need to take care of. And also, since you asked about ethics, so even if, like, you data, how much time do you do you actually need to use the data in an ethical way? So that is another question. So having data does not guarantee you that you should be using that data. Let's take a simple case. Suppose you were like applying for a personal loan, and this time online, right? After you fill up the first few pages of the application, you decide to abandon the application process. Now that you have put your phone number and email in the form, is it okay for the bank to call you up and push you to take a personal loan product? Scenario these days, right? But let us try to see it from its offline equivalent. Its offline equivalent would be, you go to a bank, you take a form from the counter, you start filling with, after you changed your mind and then threw the form in the trash. Now, trash can is inside the bank's premise. Would it be ethical for the institution to pick up your incomplete form from the trash, get your contact details and call you back? So these are some of the ethical questions that we need to address all the time. The second issue, I think what you were asking about is like data security and transparency. So transparency is one of the key issues that we encounter. The automated decision making, it might not be transparent. Suppose you applied for again the personal loan, and based on the parameters that you provided, it declines your application. So nobody would actually know why your application got rejected. Not you, but nobody. Because there is no way to tell you back why. Thus, most of us, we have a little visibility and knowledge about how AI systems, they take decisions, and as a result, how these results are being applied. Many of the algorithms they are used in machine learning cannot be examined to understand specifically how and why a decision has been made. This is specifically true for some of the popular algorithms like deep learning. And as humans, we must be able to understand how decisions are made. So if we do not understand that, then we might not be able to trust the systems. Now, so far, this is an area of nascent stage where we are trying to make AI and data science more explainable. The other challenge is the mindset. I mean, despite the importance of analytics and data science technologies have created themselves, there is a need to explain the end user about how accumulating and analyzing the data right can be useful. Most analytics leaders, they still believe that what we believe is that it is one of the very important tasks for us to educate people about what data can do, what we can do. And we have seen that some of these stakeholders, they are attuned to the old ways of working, and they could not readily see the value of the numbers. So again, the onus is on us to explain them that, hey, you see that this is how our solutions can help you. And then talking about data security, the one that you ask. Yes, of course, like being in data science and especially in the banking domain. So this is something that should be very careful of, that the data that we are dealing with, it is like not only data, but like very sensitive data. And we should have all the security. So in fact, if you, is quite innovative, but then there is a question on the security, like there is no way in which we should be proceeding that, we should be scraping it, because a security or a data leak, it can create havoc to your reputation, and it can do more harm than all the good work that you have done till now, and it can severely affect the trust that people are having on us. In the last, very last, I will quickly tell you about how to partner in data science, or maybe how data science, right? I mean, of course, you may be interested in data science, but it can get into data science. So how does that typically works? So let's take again a simple example. Suppose where you have been asked to increase the overall customer satisfaction of your client. Now that sounds quite vague, isn't it? How exactly do you define customer satisfaction, and how can you increase it? You might have no clue in the beginning. Or you might, right? If you have the well. So you might come with the different hypothesis on what could be the customers. Is it the pricing? Is it the customer service, quality of your product that is driving dissatisfaction? What these issues, or is it something else? So you talk to different departments, different executives to get their views, and then you list them all. Now you need to source data. Do you have data of the historical log of the complaints in the say past 5 years? Do you have customer care call speech data? It must be audio files, right? The customer care call speech data and might be huge in volume. What about adding data from external sources? Maybe data of what your customers are talking about you in Facebook, in Twitter, in LinkedIn. Data of maybe reviews app, if you have an app in say Google Play Store or Apple App Store, right? So you need to extract all this data, store it in a proper storage container, say a database. Then you will have to connect to the database using say SQL and then clean the data. During the data cleaning, you are likely to encounter hundreds of nuances like missing data, outliers, null values, improper formats, and so on. For the unstructured data like text data and voice, convert them into machine readable formats. So you'll have to spend a lot of time doing exploratory data analysis. And unlike popular belief, data scientists, they spend about 80% of their time cleaning the data, because the rest of the part, it is rather like easier, right? So during that cleaning and exploratory part, you'll be looking at code distributions. You will come up with a clear and concise definition of what dissatisfaction means and who are the dissatisfied customers. So this will help you to frame your objective to say to identify the early indicators of customer dissatisfaction. You'll probably be doing some feature engineering to come up with derived fields, which will give you more direct ways of measuring dissatisfaction. You will then build a simple model to predict customer dissatisfaction. You will build a lot more maybe competing and see how each one performs in predicting your target. Now the model that you finally selected, you can fine tune its parameters, optimize it, paste it on a different holdout data set to see if your predictive power still holds good. Excellent. So you have come up with a model to predict customers who are dissatisfied. Say you have also managed to convince your management by building impressive visualizations of data and scenario simulations, which will save the you will explain them and convince them that this will be a lot in terms of saving. But now what? So you'll have to use the model to get or spread negative word of mouth public.
Just hold audience, please hold on. I think we just missed him because of his network issues. Just give me a moment, I'll be back.
So you can explore different strategies as soon as they show an early indicator of dissatisfaction and offer immediate remedial measure. Sounds fun, right? So, well, this is something which data scientists. So the first data science problem, solve them, and then again convert it back into a business problem to convince your business stakeholders.
Shubhadev, I think you are facing some network issues. We lost you in between. So if you can just check your network, because we will be having a QA session and we have quite a few questions for you.
All right, sorry. I'm sorry about
no,
this. When did you lose me?
Last 2 minutes, I guess. There was coming and going, to and fro was there.
Oh, okay. No, what I was saying is that, you see, like there are three different skill sets that need. One is about the technical skill sets of codings, data knowledge, models and algorithms. The second one is about the backbone of what are the things that we do. That is, we need to have a sound knowledge of mathematics and statistics. And the third thing that we should have, and probably you are already good at, is having a domain knowledge and excellent communication skills, right? So that we can convert a business problem into an analytical problem, solve it, and then convert into a business problem to convince our business stakeholders. And this last image of the bald man, which you see here on the right hand bottom corner. So this is something which I was like building from my blog. So I was trying to see how these skill sets of the data scientists, they should look like at various stages in their career. So for this purpose, I scraped the job postings of all the data science related jobs in Naukri.com and created word clouds color coded the by the type of the skill set. So the one that I have here is for the freshers.
We lost you again. Shubhadeep. I think he is facing some network issues.
The things are expected from about the toolbox of a data scientist.
I think you need to repeat this for us because we lost you again. Hello. I think there is some issues because it is showing your network is dropping. So if you can kindly repeat that the things which are required by the freshers to get into data science, which you were actually addressing.
Hello. Hello.
Yes, you're back. Yes,
oh, perfect,
yes,
you're
back.
Yep.
Yeah,
no,
yeah.
The last thing that that I was saying is about the image of the bald man at the bottom right corner. So this is what I built. Top postings in Naukri.com to see what are the expectations from somebody who is new in the field of data science. So these are some of the skills that will make them useful. So some knowledge about the core toolkits like R and Python, some knowledge about the algorithms like deep learning and text mining, some knowledge about mathematics and statistics, and maybe some experience in internship. So with that in mind, I think this is all that I had to present. In fact, in the interest of time, I just checked the time. So yeah, feel free questions.
Thank you. First of all, thank you for such a wonderful, informative session. I can't express in words that how informative it was for us because we are really naive in this reach, this part. As you see, the time flew, and the chat box shows that how everybody was engrossed in the discussion. We have few of the questions which you have to attend, and probably we need you one more time to in order to understand that the application in little better way. My first question, which I have already taken up, was regarding data security. So which you have already answered for quite elaborate way. So I'm not going into that. My second question, which is the application of data science technology, or like when you are using a data science technology, it is expensive. Like for big corporations like HSBC or any other, Amazon, like they don't have crisis for finance. It's available. But what happens? balance is, like, can application of data science be used by SMEs, small and medium enterprises? As you know, there is a perception that it could not be afforded by these companies. And so, like, until and unless, because these, the audience which you have, they are like budding entrepreneurs or managers who have things on their mind that I want to start a new business. So is it possible that not having a huge amount of capital, but still we can use these technologies for our benefit?
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. No, this is a very valid question. And in fact, this was even more valid if, say, 10 years back, because at that point in time, like, data science was probably for the rich companies. And those are the ones who are primarily invested, investing in this area, right? But now, a lot of effort on democratizing this data science. And if we see some of the things, like most of the tools that we are now using, it is open source, it is available for free. If we are talking about tools like R and Python, they are available for free. If we are talking about some of the SQL databases, say for the ones who are the SMEs who are recently starting up, they can use, say, MySQL or Postgres SQL, which are again free. And in fact, so they can virtually start for free. They can hire some like data scientists and a team of data engineers to begin with. And as soon as they realize that it is generating value for their business, they can further decide on expanding their scope. And when they are expanding their scope, the best thing to do now is to move over to the cloud so that you can easily scale up and down based on your requirement. So you don't need to make any upfront purchases of software or hardware, or you don't need to make a data warehouse on your own basis. So that has been a very big boon in this industry.
Okay, that's great. So because you mentioned about two things like data scientists and engineers, which I had in my list of questions, is that can you tell us about the data teams, the structure of the in a lead position? So what is the structure of any particular data team when we are looking at it? Like, what would you, or how we will be distinguishing the role of data scientist, data engineer, and data analyst? Like, they sound very glorifying, but we need to know how differently they are contributing to a particular team.
Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. No, this is another very good question. So in fact, if we look at the different roles, let's start with data analysts. So data analysts are the ones who I was referring to, as they are the ones, they should be liaising with the business partners, with the stakeholders. They should be understanding the business problem. They should have excellent domain knowledge. And then based on their like consultancy skill, they would be able to convert like business problems into data science problems, so that the data scientists and the data engineers, they can actually work on them. And then once there is a solution, then again, the onus lies on the data analyst to convey it, to pitch it to the business stakeholders and to make it big, right? So that is about the data analyst. So the data scientist, so they are the ones who are into the machine learning and say neural networks, so those algorithm parts of things, right? So they will be building models, they will be trying to figure out that what particular model works for which particular business problem, right? They will do some basic data cleaning and all, right? But the data engineers, their role is also very critical, because if you are planning to source data to build an enterprise level solution, then we need to lay the pipelines so that we can get data on a maybe real-time basis or on a like batch processing basis. We process them, and then once a model has been built, like, it is no use unless we are deploying it right. And the data engineers, they will help in the deployment process. So they will be developing the APIs, or maybe the hosting the model in the form of a visualization or as a web page. So everything that goes with, say, laying the pipelines and implementing the models. So you see that they all work in tandem.
Yeah.
and neither of them they can function without the help of the others.
Correct, right. So knowing that, my next question is, okay, before I take up the next question, my request to the audience is, can you please fill up the feedback form which has been posted in the chat box. Okay, so coming back to the question, Shubhadeep, how to capture data efficiently? Also, which data to capture is also a big question, because how do we know which is going to solve our what problem? And like, you know, capturing happens in several different ways. So how it is relevant to one particular business, like how do we understand that?
Right. So if we look at the digital footprint, so the rule of thumb is to capture everything that you can possibly do, because at a later stage, maybe you can see that you don't think that will not be of much use today. Maybe at a later date, there is a use case for which that data might become critical, right? But if you are looking at something like collecting data on your own to create, say, for example, if you are going for survey data, so that is when you need to be like super careful about what kind of data that you need to capture. Because say if you are like going with a survey, you need to in fact come up with the exact hypothesis, the exact objective of the thing that you are trying to solve. You need to check that who are the people to whom you need to reach, what are the bias that like accidentally creep in into the data, and what measures that you can take to minimize those. And then based on that, you spend your money on those surveys and take the like collect the data in the exact format in which you need. But anyway, if there is a, if like it does not involve any additional effort from your end, say for example, if you are putting up a retail store which will collect data, so it's better to capture everything that you can.
Great. So you have very pertinently taken up individual industries and given examples so that we are able to intelligence is helping us in our day-to-day life. Hello.
Yes, you are audible, Dr. Payal.
Okay. So, I would like to know, how can data analytics be used to provide a boost in agriculture sector, because that is one of the primary sector of Indian economy. So, if you can just throw some light on that.
Absolutely. So, there are a few use cases in agriculture as well. Say, for example, so there are different types of fertilizers which are used, right, to maximize the yield, and then it is about the data science which can help you in finding that what exactly is the like the fertilizer to use for a particular geography based on the soil quality, right? So this is more of an optimized exercise that maybe using a few data points will not help, but if you have the entire data of say the entire state, so then this they can be very helpful. And then there are some like high-end analytics which were done on consolidation of land. So there are like video images taken from the bird's eye view of the different plots of the agricultural farms. So it is often seen that the agriculture, the farmers, they have very fragmented land with them, right? And they will have to maintain the different fragments, and some fragments are kind of say a kilometer away from the other fragment. So it was seen that if the land quality is very same, then like those video images can be processed to see that how best the fragmented land pieces can be combined together into a like single coherent piece, so that it becomes easier for the farmers to manage. So those are like some of the use cases that I can recall off the mind, but definitely there are like a lot of other use cases too. Dr. Payal, you are on mute.
Sorry.
Dr. Pal, we are losing you. Sorry, you are breaking up a bit.
Hello.
Yeah, now you are audible.
Can you hear me now? Yeah, okay.
Yeah.
Just a moment. Just a moment. I think my network is dropping now. Just give me a moment. So, my next question asking you is like, if you can please give us some insight into some commonly used statistical tools for diagnostic and prescriptive form of data, like the tools which you are using for that. Or when, like, at our research level stage, if you can use that, tell us. Yeah.
Right, exactly. No, for diagnostic, again, the two tools which you should be using is R and Python. So, in fact, there was a debate which was still very much prevalent till 2 years back, that if there is somebody who is newly starting in the field of data science, then what kind of toolkit that they should be taking up? Because these are all different languages, right? And for an individual, it will definitely be difficult to pick up multiple languages, and they can get confused. But right now, I think the landscape is pretty clear. 2 years back, R and Python, they were like neck to neck with about like 40% of the market share. But now, because of the ease with which Python has created libraries which directly facilitates to integrate you with deployment of whatever you are building. So Python has leaped maybe two steps forward. So if you are trying to do any exploratory data analysis or diagnostics, I would recommend that if you are not familiar with anyone and it's all new to you, then it's better to pick up Python.
That's great. Thank you for that. We'll share.
But anyway, at the same time, I would say that so you should understand that we are essentially problem solvers, and these are some of the tools in our toolkits. So it's not that we would be using the tools for the sake of using the tool. So if there is any other tool in your kitty which can equally work for your purpose, so go for it.
Thank you. Okay, my next question is, one of the major milestones in AI is Turing test, which is yet to be passed by any machine. So if you can just throw some light on that.
Yeah, absolutely. No, Turing test is more about robotics, right? So if you have watched the movie Ex Machina, right? So there you will get about that, like in order to pass the first version of the test, you need to maybe say, if you are a robot, then you need to prove yourself to somebody that you are actually not a robot. So that is the test that is more prevalent in robotics rather than in data science and analytics. But then again, like, this is interesting because most of the artificial intelligence stuffs, they should be going through this text. But another thing that I wanted to point out is that the level of artificial intelligence that we are talking here is about specific intelligence in some field. It's not about generic artificial intelligence, which humans possess, right? So I can be very good and I can develop intelligence in one particular field, maybe classifying authors according to their writing style, the example that I gave. But I will not have my skills in any generic kind of intelligence. But on the other hand, yes, so the robotics and generic, we are in a nascent stage there. But again, I think the Turing test is relevant for that.
Okay, thank you for that. Another question is related to Internet of Things. You have just touched upon it just on the same line. Yeah, many people today control their, you know, consumer durables, refrigerator, air conditioners and things like that, and also the smart devices like Alexa and Google Assistants are there. So this industry is definitely expected to and bounds in the coming years. So how is this going to add or change the business operations, and how data scientists or the role of data science you see will be there in the business of?
Yeah, absolutely. No, so IoTs, they have been mushrooming for sure. So no doubt on that. Some of the IoTs, they are simple rule based, and they will not require any, say, data science on back of it. Say, for example, when somebody walks into a room, say the ceiling fan will automatically turn on, right? Or maybe when a particular, say, chemical composition in the air purifier, it changes, then it will automatically make a call to the customer service. So those were more about, say, the science rather than data science component of it. But then again, there are a lot of scope of data science to develop. Say, for example, when you were speaking about Alexa, so the way that, say, the our voice is recognized by Alexa, so that speech to text conversation, so that it can process the text and give you the response back in the form of speech. So that is something which falls in the ambit of data science. And say, for example, as we will progress further, it will be able to identify that who is the exact person who is giving the command. Then it will be able to maybe understand the sentiment of the individual making the command, whether I am angry, or maybe at a later stage, it will be able to identify whether I am, say, sarcastic or I am like real, right? So all those things, they fall under the ambit of data science. And I'm sure that, yeah, we will reach there soon.
Okay, that's great. You are handling real time, you are working with the data, and such an important and interesting, relevant topic for today's world. I think every industry, every and the upcoming business managers who for your time. Thank you for making the schedule on Saturday. It's a weekend for it, I know, but still agreed to be with us. Thank you so much for that. So with that, we come to the end of our wonderful session with Mr. Shubhadeep Chakraborty. I, on behalf of RSB, that's Royal School of Business, and Royal Global University, thank you.